Good evening. I'm Sean Roman.
I'm Jay Kaplan.
I'm Steve Ferguson.
And I'm Scott Chapman.
And this is On the Sports Lines for July 16th, 2009. Major League Baseball begins its second part of the season, and we just had the All-Star break, so we're going to take a look at that. We're going to take a look at the Yankees and Mets, how they did. We're going to also talk about Michael Vick. We're going to talk about Steve McNair, his tragic death. And if we can get to it, we will talk about Tour de France competitor Lance Armstrong. As always, we want to hear from you, so send your emails to fanspeak@onthesportslines.com. We just might read yours on the show. All right, guys, same old song for the All-Star break. It's been over a decade, about 13 years, since the National League has got a win in the All-Star game. They got a tie a couple years ago, but they haven't won in a while. Guys, what were your thoughts on the All-Star game?
Well, I'll tell you what. First of all, can someone explain to me why two relievers were brought into the game in the third and the sixth inning? Ryan Franklin in the third inning and Trevor Hoffman in the sixth. And then Heath Bell. The guy's never pitched in any All-Star games in his life. You put him on the biggest pressure spot you can. Charlie Manuel, you didn't know what you were doing with the pitching staff.
I agree with you. Kind of shocking. What? Did I see that?
Yeah.
The thing that stood out for me, guys, was the glove work. Some serious web gems.
Yeah.
You got Albert Pujols making two fantastic plays at first base. Mm-hmm. Chase Utley ranging deep to in the hole and making the put out at second. And then, of course, you know, Carl Crawford with his grand theft home run. little side note about something, you know, Crawford and Willie Mays have something in common as All-Star Game MVPs. Mays was the last in 1968 before Crawford this year to win the All-Star Game MVP without driving in a run.
Wow. Yeah. Interesting.
How about that?
Well, for me, I mean, I got to tell you, I'm a little aggravated with the All-Star game. Because, and maybe that's because I'm a disgruntled National League fan.
But same here.
I don't like this whole home field advantage in the World Series being decided by this. Hmm. But what it was a good game, entertaining. What stood out for me was our president, Barack Obama. This guy shows up to throw out the first ball in a White Sox jacket. He's a huge fan. I mean, that's something that I would do, show up in a Mets jacket. He didn't go politically correct and wear a Major League Baseball jacket or be a homer with a Cardinal jacket. This guy showed up just like everybody else. I mean, he's an everyday guy. He brings confidence, and I really thought that was interesting.
Definitely. Mm-hmm.
You know, I love Tim Wakefield making the All-Star team.
Yeah,
42 years old, 190 wins. All those innings pitched for the Red Sox. Great to see that first time All-Star.
Yeah,
two World Series rings, they mean more than the All-Star appearances, I'll tell you that.
Oh, yeah.
All right, it's been a very interesting first half of the season. We had A-Rod missing about a month, Manny with his suspension for the steroid use, and also the Giants and a guy not named Lincecum pitching a no-hitter. So, Scott, what's your story first half?
First half. My story is league parity. I'm amazed that so many teams are still in contention for this wild card berth. I mean, this is what the people had in mind when they designed this whole system. If you look at the stats in the American League, there's seven teams separated by only 8 games for the wild card. The Yankees currently lead that 2.5 games up over the Rangers. The seventh team is the Blue Jays, and their asking price for Holiday is like a king's ransom, most likely because they still have a shot. They still are still in contention. In the National League, there's 9 teams separated by 6.5 games, including the Mets, who are 6.5 back. That's the Mets' battle in the second half. I don't think they catch the Phillies, but their battles with all these other teams trying to get this wild card.
Yeah.
I did the math, and if you include the 6 division winners, there's 22 teams that are still left with a legit chance for the playoffs. So their fans still have a chance to go there. And if I'm correct, that's 73% of the league. I mean, that's almost like the NFL, you know, parity rules.
One of those teams that you mentioned, Scott, is the Texas Rangers, who up until the week of the All-Star game were, how weird does this sound coming out of my mouth, the first place Texas Rangers.
Yeah.
Only them, you know, losing 3 or 4 to Seattle while the Angels were sweeping the Yankees, knocked them out of first place. They're a game and a half in back. Question is, are they playing over their heads? Can they sustain this? They are doing it based on some seriously good pitching led by Kevin Millwood and Scott, who? Feldman?
Feldman.
And some ridiculously improved defense. Elvis Andres has been a wizard with the glove at short, and he gets tutoring from Omar Vizquel.
Wow.
The Rangers jumped from dead last in defensive efficiency up to 6th this year. And you know what? The bullpen has been solid. Nelson Cruz.
Wow.
22 homers and 53 RBI at the break, and plus they're getting their usual good seasons from the, you know, the veteran trifecta of Young, Kinsler, and Blaylock.
Yep, yep.
Well, for me, it's the San Francisco Giants. Everybody knew they had pitching. Everybody knew Lincecum and Kane. By the way, Jonathan Sanchez, the 5th starter, just pitched a no-hitter. And what really surprised me is their offense. I mean, all of a sudden, this guy, Sandoval Kung Fu Panda, we never heard of this guy. This guy's a tremendous ball player. He can play third and first. He hits like the daylights. And then you got Benji Molina, who has really become a great number four hitter. You never would have thought so. And a kid named Patrick Ishikawa. This kid is an excellent defensive first baseman, but everybody was worried about his hitting. There was talk about Nick Johnson coming to the Giants. Guess what? You don't need Nick Johnson. This kid is the real thing.
You know, my biggest story was say it ain't so, Manny. This is one guy, best right-handed hitter I've seen in my lifetime. You look at him, his physical appearance, you would think, no way, out of all the guys in Major League Baseball, this guy is not on the juice. What did we find out? Unexpectedly, yes, he was
on the juice.
All right, guys, this is the funnest part of the show right here. Because back in April, each of you guys, you picked a Yankee and you picked a Met. Who you felt was going to be the key to the team's success on our Hot Seat Edition. All right, so we're going to see how you did as far as that goes. Are you nervous, guys?
Yeah.
All right, Jay, you are up first. Mm-hmm. Let's see what you have to say.
The guy who's key for the Yankees, the guy I mentioned back in our spring training show, and that is Brett Gardner, who, as I predicted, won the center field job. He has got to get on base and steal bases from the nine spot, which, let's face it, guys, in the American League is a de facto number two leadoff spot anyway.
Okay, how are you going to grade Gardner's first half?
Well, you know, I hate to call myself a prophet or pat myself on the back, but
I'm giving Brett
a B+. Only because of his slow start. He hit 220 in April. He's rebounded 327 in May, 333 in June. He leads all American League rookies, batting average, runs scored, stolen bases, and on-base percentage. And the bonus of this, guys, is how about Melky Cabrera's improved play because of Gardner making him actually step up.
Competition does it.
12 of his 34 RBIs have either tied a game or given the Yanks the lead in the seventh inning or later.
All right, Steve, you're up. Hit the tape. Okay.
For me, it's definitely Jarvis Chamberlain, because the question I have, and I've had it for the last 2 years, why are you messing with a guy who is so good in the bullpen? And I have news for you. Mariano Rivera is not going to pitch until he's 100 years old.
All right, Steve. Grade. Jarvis Chamberlain's first half performance. Tough one.
I got to give him a C, because here's the thing. He doesn't pitch a lot of innings. Your bullpen is taxed every time he's out there. 5 innings, maybe 6 at the most, 100 pitches, velocity is down. And by the way, did you guys see him in the Mets game? How bad was his control? If the Mets had any
blood
kind
control.
Of... Yeah, thank you. If they had any kind of lineup at all, they probably would have gotten him out of the game early. So I still believe that this is a guy that's destined to be their closer in the near future.
Scott, you ready to take a look at yourself from a few months ago?
I just hope I'm not wearing the same suit. I think the man on the hot seat is Mark Teixeira. They bought this guy and gave him $180 million. And with A-Rod out, he has got to produce. He's that one man in that lineup right now that can produce runs, doesn't have to worry about sitting around for runs to be manufactured. He's an extra base machine, but he's got to start strong.
What do you give Teixeira?
I'm going to give him a B+. Only because he did not do what I expected him to do, and what he needed to do was to start strong. He started slow. Yankees languished in third place behind the Red Sox and the Blue Jays. But when they made their run, Teixeira stepped up, and he stepped up huge. He's been playing a gold glove first base, 21 home runs, 63 RBIs, deservedly started in the All-Star game. And had he stepped up in the beginning, they probably would be 3 games up instead of 3 games back right now.
Amen.
At the break.
Mm-hmm.
All right, guys, let's switch boroughs to the working class county of Queens. Steve, this time we're going to start with you. Let's see what you had to say in April.
Cool. I think it's Daniel Murphy, and I'll tell you why. That is a spot in the lineup, the number two hole, that has been a black hole in the Mets lineup for a long time. What we need is somebody who makes good contact, who really knows what they're doing as a hitter, patient, so that Reyes can steal bases. And if this kid can hit 280, maybe even 300, I think we'll solve the problem.
All right, Steve, give me a grade for Mr. Murphy.
Well, I got to give him a C. The 280, 300 hasn't happened yet. I don't know if it's going to. It's going to take a lot for him to get up to that level. Because one of the things they did was they had him playing the outfield. And anybody who saw him knows he was a horrendous outfielder.
Oh,
okay, and he pressed to the wall. Pitchers made adjustments to Daniel. He's starting to learn to pull the ball more efficiently. But I think they have found a place for him, and that's at first base. He made maybe the play of the year. And I'm not saying because I'm a Met fan. Anybody who saw that play knows how phenomenal that was. But I would say if he can continue developing and keep his patience and adjust, he may get his average back up.
Scott. Are you ready for yours now?
Let's go for it.
All right.
I'm going with Oliver Perez.
Oh, Lord.
Lord, somebody please help me with this guy. I'm a huge Met fan, and Oliver Perez is killing me. When does talent translate into results? The Mets gave him money, they gave him a chance, they brought him back, and it's very important for him to step up in this number four spot in the rotation.
Oliver Perez. All right, there's your opening.
Oliver Perez. Well, I mean, to be fair, I might give him an incomplete because he was injured. But as a disgruntled Met fan, this guy's got to get an F. I mean, he missed 10 starts, and the Mets might have been better off if he missed the six that he made. He averaged 4.3 starts in each of those innings. He's averaging over a walk an inning, which works out to roughly $1,000 per walk. He's got an ERA of 8.78, and he's got no-hit stuff. And if Jonathan Sanchez can throw one, you would think Perez should be able to throw one, and he's really got to step up and be part of the solution and not the problem in the second half of the season.
All right, Jay, close it up with regard to the Mets.
All right. The guy I'm looking at, to me, was key and has to step up. He's a guy you wouldn't normally expect, and it's David Wright. You say, who? David Wright had a great year last year. And yes, he did. But if you look underneath the numbers, David Wright, like the rest of the Mets, had a problem late in games and with two outs and runners in scoring position. They just need him to step up.
All right, this one's going to be a little tough to grade. What do you have to say?
You know what? I'm giving David Wright a C. Yeah, I know. He's hitting 325, but it's got to be the softest 325 of anybody in Major League Baseball. His power numbers are down. Only 5 homers, only 44 RBIs. I'm giving him a little slack because he has absolutely no lineup protection since Beltran went down on the 21st of June. Since Beltran's gone down, 240, 1 homer, 5 RBIs in those 20 games. He's going to have to step up and carry this team until these guys get back.
A soft 325?
Wow, soft 325.
That might get you in the Hall of Fame if you do that over a long period.
Yeah, that's, you know what?
If you're Rod Carew, it might.
More than just batting average out of David
but
Wright.
But he can't possibly be getting any pitches, though. It's him and Sheff in that lineup.
All right, the Mets are going to be starting their second half tonight against Atlanta. Yankees going to begin theirs tomorrow against the Tigers of Detroit. Steve, give me one big key for the Mets' success in the second half.
This lineup must hit, and I don't care who's in this lineup, whether they come back healthy or not. If it's Beltran, Reyes, whoever, Delgado, they've got to do that. And what that also leads me to say is the trade that recently took place. I think that this trade really favors the Mets for a lot of reasons. Number one, Francoeur, if you look at his numbers, he's averaged close to 20 home runs a year, even in his down years. Two, the guy's played 162 games, not once but twice in his career. And three, he's got a great arm, and he won the Gold Glove in 2007. Church has never really had the opportunity, and when he did, unfortunately, had the concussion. So this is a guy who's never played a lot, and I have to give Francoeur a slight edge.
You know what? For me, it's the return of Reyes, Delgado. Beltran, we don't know when he's going to come back. He hasn't even been cleared to jog. Reyes out since the 20th of May. Delgado out since the 19th. Thankfully, these guys are both starting to run a little bit, starting to swing bats a little bit. They got to come back because David Wright needs some help. And you know, the guy that I really think is, this is the make or break, and they need him to come back sooner, and that's Beltran. He was hitting 336 when he went down.
You know, yeah. If, go ahead.
I'm sorry, well, that's interesting. And to piggyback on what Jay says, you know, the Mets offense is going to be what it's going to be until help comes. And that means you can expect, at best, 2 runs against the top 2 starters of other teams, which means in order to stay in contention, they're going to need another starter to piggyback on Johan and to keep them in some of these games. I think that person's Mike Pelfrey. He had a bad June, but he's rebounded with 3 decent starts in July, and he also had a big second half, so maybe he can help carry that load and keep these guys in contention.
Guys, just imagine if we would have took this show back a year and analyzed how the Phillies were doing.
Oh, man.
All right, Scott, what's essential to the Yankees succeeding in the second half of 2009?
The Yankees, I mean, this team I think is going to make the wild card at least, but what they need to do is figure out a way to contend with the American League elite teams out there. I mean, right now, they're 0-8 versus Boston. They're 2-4 against the Angels. And those are probably their playoff opponents if they make it. If they don't win the division, they'll probably play Angels first round, have to play Red Sox in a championship series. And if you look at that and do the math, that means they're 49-25 against everybody else, but they need to figure out a way to beat these Red Sox in the second half for their confidence. And maybe the mystique of Yankee Stadium is gone, you know? Maybe it blew out with that jet stream in right field.
I think it's very simple with the Yankees. It's their pitching. And the first two pitchers, Sabathia and Burnett, they've been fine.
Yeah.
But you've got to get more than five innings out of that man we just saw, Jonathan Chamberlain. And the other guy who has to step up is Andy Pettitte, who started off the year pretty well. And lately, let's face it, he's been getting racked up pretty well. So these are the guys that have to step up. Unless you guys get Roy Halladay, possibly. If the Yankees pull that off, maybe a different story.
Not holding my breath. For me, the key to the second half is twofold. Need a big second half from A-Rod. He's getting there, 17 homers, 50 RBI at the break. But to what you said, the starting pitching has got to step up.
Absolutely.
So this magnificent bullpen, and it's become a really good bullpen, does not get destroyed with overwork. Rivera's been Rivera. Aceves has been the modern-day Ramiro Mendoza. He's been fabulous, 2.03 ERA. Hughes, an ERA under one since he's been moved
as
to
a reliever.
Bullpen.
Yeah.
Okay. So these guys have done the job. They just need the starters to step up so they don't get blown out.
After a little vacation, our fantasy genius, Mr. James Ferguson, he is back, and he's gonna lay down some knowledge on all you fantasy GMs out there in Fergie's Fantasy Minute. James.
It's mid-July, and we're getting to the second half, and I'm swinging for the fences. Let's hope this one gets out of the park. But even if it doesn't, I'll always find a way to score. Hi, I'm James Ferguson, the All-Star Fantasy Genius, here with your mid-season report. It's the All-Star break, and by now, you might be ready to break your computer. From bad breaks with injuries to players not living up to their expectations, the injury bug is becoming quite the epidemic. If you drafted any Mets, Beltran, Reyes, etc., or players such as Hamilton, Ibanez, or Sizemore, you are definitely feeling the effects by now. With your DL filling up, look for MLB teams that have already incurred injuries. There could be a temporary solution for your fantasy woes. Also, look for players who could have monster second halves, like David Ortiz, Nate McClouth, and Maglio Ordonez, if he ever gets to play. Maybe you are better staying on the bench. With that being said, it's time for Fergie's Fantasy Top 5 Hottest Bats at the Break.
Number 5.
Justin Morneau. The Minnesota first baseman has 21 home runs, 70 RBIs, and batting well over 300. He has been one of the most consistent bats throughout all of Major League Baseball in the first half. Hopefully, he continues his success through the second half of the season.
Number 4.
Jason Bay. J-Bay is just being J-Bay, hitting 20 home runs, 72 RBIs, and swiping 10 bags. Bay has Boston forgetting about Manny and thinking about a pennant instead.
Number 3.
Prince Fielder. The fat vegetarian has hit 22 home runs, knocking in 78 RBIs while batting a steady 315. He's even had a stolen base. Keep on eating that tofu and salad there, fatty.
Number 2.
Carl Crawford. With 44 stolen bases, 8 home runs, and 40 RBIs while batting over 300, Crawford continues to be nothing less than a fantasy stud across the board.
Number 1.
Albert Pujols. The machine has been just that.
Why didn't you eliminate him?
Robo Pujols is batting near 340 with 32 home runs, not to mention 85 RBIs. He's all that and a bag of microchips. Let's just hope he stays healthy. That's it for this week, folks. And until next week, I'm James Ferguson.
Thank you, James. And remember, you're able to email all your fantasy questions to James Ferguson at fantasyminute@onthesportslines.com. Steve McNair's tragic and unexpected death over the July 4th weekend has dominated the NFL talk the last couple of weeks. Also, Michael Vick's NFL future is impending after he completes his federal sentence on July 21st. Guys, give me a final thought on these two issues.
Well, as far as Steve McNair goes, I mean, you got to look at him in terms of what he did on the field, his toughness, co-MVP, and probably would have been Super Bowl MVP had his team been able to win, stopped at the goal line. I think that's really the way you look at him. You look at him in terms of his toughness, his ability, and his leadership. As for Michael Vick, let's hope there's somebody out here who actually takes this guy. He still has great ability, best left-handed thrower I've ever seen with speed to burn. And if the guy can come back in a system that works for him, you know what? I say give him another chance.
For me, as far as McNair goes, you talk, I'm going to remember him as one of the classiest guys in the NFL, a guy who was a great give-back-to-the-community guy, extensive charity work, and here's my thought on this. This should not be his legacy. This tragic end should not outweigh all the good stuff he did, both in the NFL and in life, because that stuff made him worthy of being a role model, and it shouldn't overshadow that. As far as Vic, you know what? I think you should let him play. There are guys in the NFL who are playing who have done worse to human beings. Dante Stallworth. So if somebody wants to take him, let him have his shot.
Well, I mean, on the Vick front, there's no doubt he should play. He did his time. Give him a chance. Put him back in the league. On McNair, you know, that's a different situation. It's tragic that he passed away. Nobody deserves to be gunned down. But my grandmother always told me that tab A doesn't always belong in slot B. Especially when tab A belongs to a 36-year-old married man with four kids. And slot B is a 20-year-old waitress at what? Chuck E. Cheese?
David Buster's.
I mean, you know, I mean, the lesson to be learned here is not to play with people's emotions. I'm pretty sure Mike could have got a date if he really wanted to step out on his wife without lying about I'm getting a divorce and without lying about his other women. So, I mean, I've been telling Jay for years. Jay, stay away from these 20-year-old hoes. I mean, Jay, I mean, but I bet he'll listen to me now, right?
Yeah, yeah. I will.
The memory I have about McNair is when he was a senior at Alcorn State. The numbers he put up that year were absolutely amazing. Yep. All right, guys, let's move across the Atlantic Ocean. And the one time a year we focus on bike racing. Lance Armstrong, 37 years old, 4 years away from the bike run, doing the Tour de France, looking for his eighth victory. Jay, how are things going for Lance in his comeback?
You know, I got to tell you, with Lance, he's in third place after 12 stages, 8 second back. His team has three of the top four riders. The question will be if they decide to go with Alberto Contador because he has a better chance of winning, if Lance will be a good team player and block instead of going for the win himself.
And for me, you got to love a guy who says, you know what, I'm doing this for me. You've all seen the commercial. You know what? It's great for Lance because, you know what, no one should tell you how to run your life as an adult, period. And I think it's great that he's back on the bike.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Lance is a great story. It's a great story, whether he wins or loses. It's uplifting for other battling cancer patients. I mean, I'm impressed that this guy's doing this with one testicle. I don't think that would mess up the balance on a bike, but, you know, I'm happy for him. I hope he does well.
You know, Bill Maher has a great joke that I'm going to share with the audience right now. You're not a bike racing fan unless you could name one other racer besides Lance Armstrong.
Hey, we just did. Alberto Contador.
That's right.
All right, guys. That music means it's time for the three-minute warning. Jay, lead us off.
Sports hasn't done a lot right lately. Steroid revelations continue in baseball. NFL players dot the police blotter. We've even got a NASCAR driver suspected of being a meth addict. But every once in a while, sports does something that reminds us why we love them and the teams and players that play the games. July 4th was the 70th anniversary of Lou Gehrig's Luckiest Man speech at Yankee Stadium, given by the Yankee legend not long after he was diagnosed with the disease that bears his name, amyotrophic lateral sclerosis. In honor of that and MLB's commitment to helping find a cure for the disease, Gehrig's speech was read before every game played that day and someone afflicted with the disease throughout the first pitch. On July 19th, it will be the 16th installment of the ESPYs. ESPN's annual award show has become a gala event that rivals the Oscars in terms of glitz, glamour, and red carpetness. But it's also a fundraising event for the V Foundation for Cancer Research, named in honor of the late NC State basketball coach Jim Valvano. His Never Give Up speech at the very first ESPYs in 1993, right before he passed away, was the inspiration for this. On days when it's hard to be a sports fan, we do well to remember instances like these and the words of the men who inspired them.
New York Mets trainer Ray Ramirez. When Jose Reyes had multiple leg injuries a few years ago, the conclusion was clear. The Mets trainer had to go. Now turn to 2009, sparkling new ballpark. All looked fine. But look at the Mets now, decimated by injuries and a new booby-trapped mind. Go on and laugh at them. They're a mass unit. Half the team is on the DL. And unless the Saints come calling, their season is going to hell. If they were just a team lacking in talent or heart, well, that would be bad. But it's about injuries I think could have been avoided, and that makes me mad. Some blame goes to the medical staff misdiagnosing the severity of injuries. What a laugh. Bad luck, karma, or maybe coincidence? Either way, none of this makes any sense. What kind of exercise or conditioning does this team do? I can't blame the medical staff completely, but we can start by firing you.
Yesterday, we saw the latest example of a pro athlete who can't figure out when to say when. Pedro Martinez signed with the Phillies 1 year, $1 million, then promptly was placed on the 15-day disabled list with a shoulder strain. Yeah, I know, this isn't starting well. Actually, it's precautionary to give him a few minor league starts, but even so, this is a man who spent more time on the DL than on the mound over the last three seasons. Pedro is credited with bringing legitimacy to Omar Minaya's tenure after signing in 2005. That may be true, But consider that no one in the Mets front office or their fans is losing any sleep over his signing with the hated Phillies. You then realize that the belief is he is done. I don't knock any professional athlete who wants to keep playing, but I do believe there is a point where legends become jokes. Where is the balance between leaving too soon, Barry Sanders, and leaving too late, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar? When Pedro was right, he was probably the best pitcher I ever saw. He was a great teammate, a great interview, and great for the game of baseball. He did it all with a jerry curl, a lucky midget, and no steroids. We think. I would hate to see him retire as a washed-up spot starter.
Michael Vick's sentence officially ends on July 21st, and Vick likely will make an appeal for reinstatement in the NFL to Roger Goodell. What would speak much louder than any commentator's argument on whether Mr. Vick should be permitted back in the league, and I didn't bring any pictures, but just one image of one of the many animals that Mr. Vick brutalized after not performing successfully in a dogfight. Such an image would show what separates Vick's behavior from the criminal and immoral behavior so many other active NFL athletes have committed. Specifically, Vick engaged in the intentional and sustained torture of dogs, those innocent creatures who hold a very special place in our national consciousness. Now, the NFL targets and appeals to so many demographics, but none more so than the traditional American family which dogs so often are a part of. Dog lovers make up enough of the American fabric that our common sense view of Vick's repugnant behavior should be considered by Mr. Goodell. Simply no team in the National Football League should be permitted to market a man who systematically put our lovable companions through some of the most painful experiences any living creature could go through. In closing, I sincerely hope that Roger Goodell makes the right decision in making his determination on Mr. Vick. For Jay Kaplan, Steve Ferguson, and Scott Chapman, I am Sean Roman. Thank you so much for spending part of your evening with us. We're going to be back July 30th, and we want to see you for another edition of On the Sports Lines. And remember, if you want to see this show again or catch up on any of those you missed, check us out on the web at youtube.com/onthesportslines. Good night, everyone.
Night, everybody.
Night, everyone.